Dear students, before we proceed with the clinical application of joints, let us consider the axis of moments and the terminology used while referring to the moments of joints. What is axis of movement? Axis is a straight line around which an object rotates. Movement at a joint takes place in a plane around an axis. So, the basic term that is used for describing movements of a joint, one of which is the axis of movement, which means a straight line around which an object rotates. Movement at a joint takes place in a plane around an axis. There are three axes of rotation. One is the sagittal, the other is the frontal, and the third one is the vertical. And how the axes pass and what is the intersection for this axis. For sagittal axis, it passes horizontally from posterior to anterior, and it is the intersection of sagittal and transverse planes. Frontal axis, it passes horizontally from left to right. It is at the intersection of frontal and transverse planes. Vertical axis passes from inferior to superior, and it is at the intersection of sagittal and frontal planes. In the previous slide, we have seen the three planes of the body. What are they? The sagittal plane, the frontal plane, and the transverse plane. And the movements along these planes are the axis of rotation of a joint. The sagittal plane is the frontal or the mediolateral axis. So you can see those axes and the movements in those axes in this picture of shoulder joint. You can observe the glenoid fossa and the head of the humerus. Okay, then the axis along the sagittal plane is the frontal or mediolateral axis. And what is the movement that is possible in this axis? Is the flexion and extension movements along the mediolateral axis in the sagittal plane. So, flexion is moving the arm forwards and moving the arm backwards to anatomical position is extension. Then coming to the frontal plane. The axis of rotation of joint in this plane is the sagittal or anteroposterior axis. You can see in this picture. The movements that take place in this axis are the abduction and adduction movements. Abduction and adduction movements. Abduction, moving the arm from the side of trunk. And adduction is bringing it back anatomical position. Then along the transverse plane, the axis is the vertical axis. Along the transverse plane, the axis is the vertical axis, and the movements that are possible are the medial rotation and lateral rotation. So rotating the arm medially is medial rotation, and rotating it laterally from the anatomical position is the lateral rotation. Now you know about the weights, the corresponding axes, and the moments with examples. Let me re-emphasize on the axis of moments. Look at this picture again. So the three axes of moments are the sagittal or anteroposterior axis, the medial, lateral or frontal axis, the vertical axis. So you have seen the three axes. Then what are the moments that take place in the sagittal axis or the anteroposterior axis? So the moments that are taking place are the abduction and adduction, the anteroposterior or sagittal axis. Then coming to the mediolateral or frontal axis, the movements that take place are the flexion and extension movements in the frontal axis. Coming to the vertical axis, the movements that take place are the medial rotation and lateral rotation. So these are the movements that take place along the axes. Now observe the movement that takes place in the sagittal plane and frontal axis. So what is the movement? Flexion and extension are the movements. This is flexion and back is the extension. Now look at the movement for the coronal plane and sagittal axis. This is the coronal plane and sagittal axis. What do you call these movements? Adduction and abduction. Bringing together is adduction, away is abduction. Now observe the movements at the transverse or horizontal plane and vertical axis. So this is the transverse plane and see the movements. So they are the medial rotation and lateral rotation. Medial, lateral. So rotation movements you have observed. Observe the movements. Observe the movement of the lower limb. So now you know what is that movement. What is that movement? Abduction and adduction. Similarly for the upper limb, you can see what is abduction and what is adduction. Now, answer to the questions. In which plane these movements occur? Abduction and adduction among the three planes. It is the coronal plane. Then in which axis it is taking place? Sagittal axis. Now, you know what is a plane, what is an axis, and what are the movements that take place in the axis. Now, look at the movements of the hand, spreading the fingers and bringing them closer. Now, what do you call these movements? They are abduction, spreading, and adduction, bringing together. In which plane these movements are occurring? The coronal plane. In which axis these movements are taking place? The sagittal axis. Now observe the movements of lower limb. What do you call the movements? They are flexion and extension. In which plane they are happening? The sagittal plane. In which axis these movements are taking place? Frontal axis. After learning about the axis of movements, let us learn about the degrees of freedom of movement. So what is degrees of freedom? Number of axes at which the bone in a joint can move. So among the three axes, how many number of axes through which the bone in a joint can move? That is degrees of freedom. So there are three different axes for the movements adding to the degrees of freedom. There is what is known as uniaxial movement, where movement of bone at a joint is limited to one axis only. That means one degree of freedom. And the example for this is the elbow joint, where only movement takes place along one axis only. That's why uniaxial movement. It is the flexion and extension at the elbow. Coming to the biaxial movement. In this, movement of a bone at a joint is along two axes with 2 degrees of freedom. Example is the wrist joint, where flexion and extension movements take place along one axis and adduction and abduction movements along the other axis. Then the multiaxial movement. Movement of a bone at a joint is limited to 3 axes, all the 3 axes with intermediate positions as well, in addition with intermediate position movements. So that means it is having 3 degrees of freedom. The example is shoulder joint, where flexion and extension, adduction and abduction, medial and lateral rotation movements, in addition circumduction movement take place. Now you understood the relationship between the axis of movement and degrees of freedom. Let us look into the terminology of body movements. In the case of limbs, they are the flexion, extension, hyperflexion, hyperextension. So see the movements at the wrist, flexion and extension. At the elbow, flexion and extension. And at the shoulder, the flexion, extension, hyperextension you are seeing. And in the case of the hip joint, you are seeing the flexion and extension with hyperextension movements. Some more details on the movements in the limbs. You can see what is abduction, what is adduction. So see the abduction moment and adduction moment. And then you can see here the radial deviation and ulnar deviation at the wrist. And in the case of lower limb in the feet, you can see the abduction and adduction movements of the lower limb as a whole. And then in the feet, the inversion and eversion movements. So of the foot facing medially is inversion and laterally is eversion. See the movements of internal rotation and external rotation in the lower limb, and similarly internal rotation and the external rotation in the upper limb. Here you have to follow the arrows, the direction of the arrows. And in this, here you can see what is horizontal abduction and horizontal adduction. Similarly, in the lower limb, the abduction and adduction movements in the horizontal direction. Now see the movements in the forearm. They are the supination and pronation movements. This is supination, this is pronation. Supination, pronation. And in between positions is the mid-prone position. Mid-prone position. Okay. Let us learn some more terminology in relation with the ankle. The image itself is self-explanatory. So, the movements are the dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. This is dorsi, this is plantar. Dorsiflexion, plantar flexion. So, in the forearm, the movements are the pronation and supination. And in the ankle, it is the plantar flexion and dorsiflexion. In the case of trunk, what do you call those movements? There is flexion of the trunk, forward bending and backward bending is the extension from the anatomical position. Then flexion or bending towards the sides is the lateral flexion and lateral extension. These are the movements in the trunk. So observe the flexion and extension movements in the trunk. So the flexion, forward bending and backward bend is the extension of the trunk. Let us see the terminology of movements for the mandible or chin. They are called the protraction, forward movement, and going back to anatomical position is the retraction of the mandible. Then the other one is bringing it down is the depression, and bringing it back into anatomical position is the elevation movement in relation to the mandible. Here, this is the movement of circumduction along the shoulder. Okay, passing through the three axes and having the movement of the abduction, flexion, extension, adduction. So these are the movements of the circumduction. Look at another movement of the thumb, known as the opposition. So thumb coming in contact with the tips of the other fingers. That is the opposition moment. Now, let us give examples for clinical application of joints. Only few examples will be given to you. One is the arthritis. So, inflammation of the joints. There is what is known as rheumatoid arthritis or osteoarthritis, which is common with old age. The other types, psoriatic arthritis and gout. In these cases, the involved joints will be swollen, as you are seeing in this picture, and they are painful, and there will be restriction of movements. You can see the thickened synovial membrane and degraded articular cartilages, and see the synovial fluid here. So, in the case of arthritis, the joints will be swollen, painful, and there is restriction of movement. The other clinical application of knowledge of joints, anatomy and structural basis for these joints is in arthroscopy. Arthroscopy is a procedure for visualization of a joint cavity and for treating the joint problems. Here you can see the arthroscopy of the knee joint. A fiber optic video camera is passed through a small incision into the joint cavity. The image is transmitted to the video monitor. So, this procedure is arthroscopy. Now, let us learn what is arthroplasty. It's an orthopedic surgical procedure where the articular surfaces of a joint, see in this picture in relation with the knee joint, the articular surfaces of a joint are replaced or remodeled to restore the function of the joint. So, like in total hip replacement and total knee replacement. So, arthroplasty is a surgical procedure where articular surfaces of a joint is replaced or remodeled for restoring the function of the joint, like in the hip replacement surgeries and total knee replacement surgeries. Now let us see another clinical application of joints. Sprain. There will be tear of ligament which causes severe pain because of fluid effusion in the ligament and joint, and there will not be any dislocation. In the picture, you can see the knee sprain where there is the lateral collateral ligament or fibular collateral ligament is torn. See the normal tibial collateral ligament here. Then see this picture. So, which ligament is torn? The medial collateral ligament is torn. And see another picture here. So here the medial collateral ligament is torn and the anterior cruciate ligament is also torn. So when there is a tear of a ligament, it can produce sprain where there will be severe pain because of fluid accumulation in the joint, and there will not be any dislocation. Now let us learn what is dislocation. Dislocation. There is loss of contact between two articulating bones. So dislocation is loss of contact between the two articulating bones. So common cause of dislocation is trauma. The dislocation can cause pain, loss of function, and deformity. It is diagnosed by X-ray. So you can see here, this is a healthy joint. You are seeing the healthy knee joint. And here you can see the dislocated knee joint. So there is loss of contact between the two articulating bones. And what is subluxation, the other term? If the contact is retained, though there is displacement, but the contact is retained, it is called subluxation. Now you know what is sprain, what is dislocation, and what is subluxation of a joint. Now, let us see another clinically important condition, neuropathic joint. It's caused by leprosy, tapis dorsalis, and the joints show painless swelling and bone destruction. So there is a neuropathic joint caused by leprosy and tapis dorsalis. The joint shows painless swelling and bone destruction. Now, let us see another surgical procedure, osteotomy, where a bone is cut to shorten or lengthen it or change its alignment. If it has healed in an abnormal fashion following fracture. So, osteotomy is a surgical procedure where they cut a wedge of bone to shorten or to lengthen or change its alignment if it has healed in an abnormal fashion after fracture. It is also used to correct deformities of the limb like coxa vara and valga deformity of hip, genu valgum deformity of knee, and genu varum, where the legs will be in the form of a bow. After learning the topic of joints, their definition, the classification, the features and subtypes with examples and the various body movements, the axes of body movements, degrees of freedom and clinical application of joints, let us see whether you will be able to answer these questions. Classify joints, giving examples for each. Describe the general features of synovial joints. Describe the features of fibrous joints and classify them with examples. Classify synovial joints with examples. Write the differences between symphysis and synchondrosis and bursa.